All right, we are going to do a study today on what it means to be a steward of the mysteries, according to the King James Bible. There are some people that say that there are seven mysteries in the King James Bible. Well, actually, there are a few more. We're going to look at each of the references to the word mystery in the New Testament here as far as the ones that are pointed at Christians. There are a few in the Gospels we're not going to be covering because it's just parallel verses between the Gospels that they're basically saying the same thing. But we came across this the other morning in our devotions. We're in the book of 1 Corinthians right now in our morning devotions. And I saw this verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 4. You can turn there. And it was just like, you know, that still small voice said to me, you know what, you don't have a sermon on this. The mysteries, what it means to be a steward of the mysteries. So I thought about it. I thought, you know what, I need to put something together on the being a steward of the mysteries. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2 is where we're going to start today. There's going to be quite a few scriptures to go over in our study. It says here, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Wow, what an amazing thing there. All God requires of you when you get to the judgment seat of Christ is, were you faithful? All right. God will commit certain mysteries to you as a Christian that the lost world can't understand. And it's very interesting because so many of the things we debate with people back and forth are the mysteries. You might not even be aware of it yet, but after this study, you're going to be aware of it. The fact that there's a lot of the arguments and dissension that you have among professing Christians, it's over the mysteries. Saved people get the mysteries, lost people don't. That's what separates us. I'm going to show you the scriptures for it. But all that's really required of you as a Christian, working for the Lord and things like that, the Lord's going to, I mean, you can go out and try to force feed people salvation, and all that you're going to do is just send people to hell, okay? You make people uncomfortable with the thing of, just forcing this, you got to get saved, you got to get saved, you got to come to our church and all this other stuff. You know, I used to see that thing going door to door. You know, I saw it firsthand. You're not creating converts. You're creating false converts is what you're doing. What you need to do is you need to wait for the Lord to open that door of utterance. Witness to people, pass out gospel tracts, sure. But if that person, if they are not ready for salvation, you're just wasting your time, right? And worse than that, you could actually be giving them a false sense of salvation, which happens quite a bit. But I need to make this point very, very, very clear. If you get down sometimes and you think to yourself, boy, what have I really done for the Lord? What he's going to judge you for is right there in verse 2. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Now, these passages here, these two verses here, you know, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. It's specifically pointed at pastors, okay, preachers and teachers like myself, all right? It's specifically pointed at us that I'm supposed to be a steward of the mysteries. But I believe that the New Testament teaches the priesthood of the believer. Okay, in other words, God's committed to all of us the ministry of reconciliation. We are ambassadors for Jesus Christ, whether male or female. Doesn't matter. The only difference there is when you get into the assembly of the saints, when they come together, God says, okay, the women shouldn't be over that assembly. But women have all the privileges and rights and everything else to witness to the lost, and the responsibilities too. You say, well, boy, I haven't really led too many people to the Lord. You know, I haven't really had many conversions and things. Are you faithful with the mysteries? You say, well, I'm not really sure what the mysteries are, brother. Okay, then let's have the study here. All right, it's going to be a good one. Okay, let's go to Luke, the book of Luke. Back to the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Chapter 8. I'm going to show you that Jesus was basically preparing, you know, his disciples for what would eventually come during this church age that we're in after, you know, Jesus died on the cross, was buried and rose again, and the New Testament comes in. Now this thing continues that Jesus is setting up here. Luke chapter 8, verse 9. Let's start there. And his disciples asked him, saying, "What might this parable be?" And he said unto you, excuse me, and he said unto you, "It is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand." Oh boy, get a hold of that one. Okay. Lost people, they don't understand what it means to be a Christian. And it's so interesting because I've seen this thing with false converts, and I mean wicked, not just false converts, false prophets. They will try so hard to imitate Bible-believing Christianity. I mean, there are some guys with PhDs, master's degrees, whatever else, and they study Bible-believing Christianity, but they don't quite get it. Why? They're not born again. So they can parrot what they've learned in some seminary or Bible college or whatever else, but they don't get the mysteries. They'll get mixed up on the mysteries. All right? But the kingdom of God there in verse 10, see, there you have in the Gospels, there are two kingdoms mentioned, the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven is always 100% of the time, always a reference to a physical kingdom on the earth with its headquarters in Jerusalem that will be coming in the millennial kingdom. Okay, again, I've done other studies on that. I can't get into that in great detail here, but you can look up Matthew chapter 11. Let me just, I think it's 11 verse 12. Let me just make sure of that quickly. Yes, Matthew chapter 11, verse 12, "And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force." Okay, so the people say, well, that's heaven where God is. Nobody that's violent is going to take heaven by force from God. Okay, it's talking about a physical kingdom on the earth. Kingdom of heaven only appears in the book of Matthew, and it always, 100% of the time, refers to the kingdom that is coming, the millennial kingdom with Jesus in Jerusalem, as, you know, sitting there ruling and reigning for the 1,000 years. The kingdom of God, on the other hand, the kingdom of God can be both. It can be a reference to the kingdom of heaven, but usually it's a reference to the spiritual kingdom, fellowship between us and the Lord. All right, and you can see there's a verse, I can't think of where it is right now, but it talks about, you know, that the time will come when the Jews are basically going to see, you know, Gentiles sitting down with you know, Moses and Abraham and Isaac, you know, and all these fathers of the Jewish people. And they're going to be sitting down in the kingdom of God, and the Jews are going to be thrust out. All right, so that's a reference to the kingdom of God being like the kingdom of heaven. Okay, you don't sit down in something spiritual. You're sitting down in something physical. But if you want to tie in to this thing of the kingdom of God here being spiritual, you can go back to Romans chapter 14, just to show you here real quickly. Romans 14 verse 17 says, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink," those are physical things, "but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost." All right. So when you read in the Pauline epistles about the kingdom of God, most of the time it's talking about that spiritual fellowship between you and the Lord, where you have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Right, it's not talking about something physical. So there is application, in other words, because I know somebody could say, well, yes, but Brother Brian, this is before the cross, you know, so this is technically in the Old Testament, dispensationally in the Old Testament, where you have, again, just if you're new, I know there's a lot of new Christians that don't understand the dispensational thing. I have videos on my other channel explaining dispensations in a lot greater detail. And dispensation is a Bible word, by the way. We're going to see that later on, but just to explain what dispensations are, okay, there are different periods where God dispenses His grace in different methods, by different means, His grace leading to salvation, okay, His grace is always there, God always has grace, all right, but He dispenses it different ways throughout these different dispensations. It's a Bible word. Well, like I said, we're going to see that in a little bit. So yes, I understand this as it's being this, as this time as it's being recorded there, they're technically in the Old Testament. The Old Testament lasts until the death of the testator, Hebrews chapter 9, verses 15 through 17, if I think correctly there. Hebrews chapter 9, you can look it up. The New Testament comes in with the death of the testator. Jesus Christ died on the cross, that brings in the New Testament. His blood shed on the cross brings in the New Testament. Okay, so technically understand this is in the Old Testament, but we see it carry through into the Pauline epistles, this thing of the mysteries being committed only to saved. Let me show you another verse that's very important here. Turn in your Bible to John chapter 14. John chapter 14, beginning in verse 15. This is going to be a big Bible study today. We're going to definitely going to be getting a lot of scripture in here. John chapter 14, verse 15. Again, remember, Jesus said, they're saying, why do you speak to us in parables? And Jesus says, because I don't want these lost people to understand the mysteries that I'm giving to you, essentially. Let's read here. John 14, verse 15. If ye love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, look at this, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. He doesn't say he is in you. Okay? The promise of the Holy Spirit coming upon them happened after salvation. They weren't saved at this point in time, according to the way we are today. Okay, Jesus dies on the cross, the blood is shed. Now that way is going to be there. All right? But notice, lost people can't receive the Holy Spirit of truth. You'll see that as we go through this study. Verse 18, I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. But ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. Which is what we have today. Jesus is prophesying the future, the salvation that we have today. Verse 21, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. Judas saith unto him, not Iscariot, the other Judas, one of his disciples, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the world? I mean, think of it this way. Jesus says, hey, I'm gonna manifest myself to you by making it rain. Well, if it kind of rains just on your property and nobody else, well, that would be kind of, you know, kind of like, what's going on there? It's kind of weird or whatever else. How would Jesus manifest himself to us and not to the world? Let's continue reading. Verse 23. Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words. And my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Do you have his words? I do. I have a King James Bible. You say, well, my NIV is just as good. No, it isn't. Look at the source where it came from. It goes back to the Vatican. Vaticanus and Sinaiticus, the two big Greek texts, the older and better and all this other stuff. And watch my Real Bible Version Issue Exposed if you want to know the truth about the NIV and all the other ones. They're wicked. Okay? You say, well, the original autographs. Okay, you don't have the original autographs. You say, well, that's only the only perfect standard, you know, perfect copy of God's Word. You know, and I just, let me just interject another little thought if you're new to this whole thing. Somebody says to you, only the original autographs could be considered the perfect Bible. You just heard from a liar when you hear that. You say, what are you talking about? There was never a point in time in history where all of the originals from Genesis to Revelation were in one volume. So somebody says only the original autographs consist of a perfect Bible. They come together as the perfect Bible. They're lying. Or you know, usually parroting the lies of some, you know, Jesuit seminarian that's taught them. But let's continue. Verse 24. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, there is defined, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Can you fake that? No. Some lost person can get a bunch of books like this, and they can read these books and they can say, I can talk just like a Bible-believing Christian. I can copy Ruckman and I can copy other people and I can act like this guy and that. Here's Charles Spurgeon and there's John Wesley and there's William Tyndale and J. Frank Norris and Sam Jones and Billy Sunday, and I can copy these guys and come out looking like a Christian. But you'll spot them after a while. They'll start to slip up. Why? Because God's not revealing the truth to them. And I've seen this thing, I've seen it and seen it and seen it. People infiltrating or trying to infiltrate the Bible-believing movement, and they'll just repeat. They repeat and repeat and repeat because they've studied. See? But they lack that Holy Spirit of truth. And all of a sudden, you'll be watching them and you'll just go, I don't know what it is. Something about them, just, I don't know. It's something, I don't know. You'll feel it. You will feel it. And by the same token, as a Christian, you're going to be talking with people and things like that. I see this in the comments all the time, and people are like, wow, you know, brother, I was I was reading through that same portion of scripture, and I thought, I wonder if it means this, and you just preached it. And I'm, wow, you know, I can't tell you how many times that we've had that fellowship of the Spirit. You know, it's incredible. I mean, there have literally been times where my wife and I will be talking about a video project, or do you think maybe we ought to do something about such and such? We'll get a letter in the mail that was sent a week, 2 weeks beforehand, and it says, hey, could you please do a video on the very subject that we were just talking about doing a video on? I can't tell you how many times that's happened. You know, I had a situation here recently. I'm not going to say a whole lot of details on this, but I had a situation where I had bought a Bible for somebody in another country because they can't ship local church Bible publishers over, which I don't really understand that. But, you know, I had bought a Bible and I didn't hear back from that person. And it's gone like, you know, a year probably. And I'm just going like, okay, what am I going to do with this Bible? You know, I'll just keep it around for the right time. All of a sudden, boom, the right situation shows up and it's just like right there. This is the perfect one. This is, oh, wow. And I've seen that thing happen. It's incredible. We have the Holy Spirit within us, and the lost world can't fake it. They try to fake it with their little funny, you know, sign gifts and whatever else. But it's so funny too, you know. Oh, this person's got the Spirit of God moving upon them. Oh, look at them. They're spiritual. You know, and stuff. Stupid nonsense. That's not the Spirit of God. You want to know what the real evidence of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you know, when the Holy Ghost comes upon you? What's your attitude towards the truth? The Spirit of truth comes upon you, and all of a sudden you don't care much about anything else in this world but truth. And you start to say, you know what, I want to know the truth no matter what it costs. Don't you? Yeah. So let's start looking at the mysteries. Because the mysteries are given to stewards. We're to be faithful stewards of the mysteries of God. I'm supposed to commit them to you. I'm a preacher. But you know what? As a Christian, you're supposed to think on these mysteries. And I'm going to tell you right now, most of these mysteries cannot be understood. That's another thing that's very important to understand. Most of these mysteries you're not going to understand with your mind, your fleshly mind down here. The Bible says the just shall live by his faith, right? Old Testament, in New Testament, the just shall live by faith, all right? We're supposed to live by faith. And so a lot of these mysteries that come, you just go, could you, you know, somebody says, can you explain this to me? No. Why do you believe it? Because it's in the Bible. And the Holy Spirit reveals it to me, and I say, yeah, it makes sense to me. And you're going to see a lot of these mysteries that when you hear them, you're not going to understand all these mysteries the moment that you get saved, but they will be revealed to you. And as you hear them, you're going to go, well, yeah, that makes perfect sense. Why? Because you're born again. You have the Holy Spirit that guides you into all truth. But when you see these people and they say, I reject these things, and you look at it and you do the study, which we're going to get into, if I keep, you know, I get to it, but you get somebody and they reject different truths and they're actually rejecting the mysteries, and you understand that. I'll tell you what, this study here, just doing the putting the notes together, has really opened up my eyes to a lot of things. I struggle with a lot of these people that just don't get the mysteries, and they're not ignorant. They've heard the arguments, but it's not being revealed to them. Why? Because they're not saved. Let me show you. Romans chapter 11. Look at the first mystery for a Christian. Romans chapter 11, verse 25 through 28. And you can do this word study on your own, by the way, too. This isn't some thing that, you know, whatever, some special deal. Just look up the word mystery in the Pauline epistles. Romans chapter 11, verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery. There's the word. Lest ye should be wise in your own conceits. What is the mystery? That blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in, and so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob, for this is my covenant unto them when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. What's the mystery? The current condition of the nation of Israel. I've seen some Jews get saved in my time in ministry as a result of this ministry. And I thank the Lord for that. I mean, you talk about an honor. It's a wonderful thing. But the mystery is, you look and you go, these people, I mean, I've seen things from these Jewish rabbis and things, the Torah Institute and stuff, and you watch and you're just like going, they have a zeal for God. They're just like, how can't you get it? It's a mystery. Why? Because they rejected Jesus Christ as their Messiah nationally back when he was here the first time. That's the reason for the time of Jacob's trouble coming, to correct the nation of Israel. Turn back to Ezekiel 36. You will run into lost people that don't get it. The Jews are wicked. The Jews reject Jesus. They you know, read the Babylonian Talmud and they said Jesus is a, you know, some product of some, you know, Roman soldier and Mary and blah 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 blah. The Jews are wicked, vile creatures. They should be killed off the face of the earth and stuff. You're going to run into that, especially nowadays. I mean, it's getting worse and worse. The likes of little Steven Andersnake and his little Princess Patrol. I make fun of them, yeah, you know I do, and I always will. Ezekiel 36, verse 21, I really do, honestly, I really do believe that Steven Anderson is a sodomite, you know, I do believe that's there. He just has the kind of mannerisms and look of it and everything else, and I think that that could be an eventual thing, that they'll bring it out, you know, Baptist pastor Steven L. Anderson, you know, Faithful Word Baptist cult, you know, And he's got all these children and everything else, and it turned out that some gay boyfriend of his came out and said that we were together, and here's pictures, or, you know, and it's all, oh, it's supposed to, like, make Baptists look bad or something ridiculous, or Bible believers, you know. Wouldn't surprise me one bit. I mean, the guy, you know, gays should be killed and all this other stuff, and he's working with Paul Wittenberg, who worked in Hollywood on a movie set, you know, about sodomy. A pro-lesbian film. But, you know, that's... let's just not talk about that. Yeah. Ezekiel 36, verse 28. I have the video that proves that, too, by the way. If you're interested, you can look it up. Ezekiel 36, verse 21. Because another one of the things that you're going to hear is they're going to say, the Jews are wicked. They reject Jesus Christ. So they can't be God's chosen people. See, they don't get the mystery. They don't understand that blindness, in part, is happened. In other words, let me say this too, that blindness in part there means that it's not all Jews are lost and all, you know, spiritually blinded by God. No, it's in part. There are some Jews that do get saved. Like I said earlier, we've seen a few of them get saved. And praise the Lord for them. I love to hear that. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 21. But I had pity for mine holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the heathen, whither they went. Therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord God, I do not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for mine holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the heathen, whither ye went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord God, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Did that happen in the first century? No. They were not a nation when Jesus was walking around on the earth, as far as having their own government and their own rules and whatever else. They were under Roman rule. And you have Stephen Andersnake and his little, you know, anti-Semitic Nazi buddies, and they say, all the prophecies of the Old Testament were fulfilled before Jesus showed up. It's like, are you stupid or something? Or just wicked? Or both? You know, I want to be fair, okay? You know, Noah, this is happening today. And notice they come back to the land. God brings them back to the land in unbelief. So you see, as a Christian, you know, you hear about this and you go, yeah, it makes sense. You know, I can get it. I've seen Christians, they go, yeah, you know, why would I hate the Jewish people? You know, what's the deal? But when you see somebody and they go, I refuse, you Zionist pig, you Jew lover, you, and they get all this anger stuff. It's like, whoa, okay, what are you dealing with? Somebody that God has not revealed the mystery to. A lost person. We can't agree to disagree on the issue of Israel being in the land and that's fulfilling prophecy. We can't agree to disagree on that. We can't agree to disagree that God has plans for the nation of Israel in the future. Well, I have friends that are anti-Semitic and I still love them and we're all saved. No, they're not. No, they're not. If you don't get the mystery there of blindness in part happening to Israel, you're not saved. The mysteries are committed to Christians. Holy Spirit of truth comes and he shows us these mysteries. Let's go to the next one. Romans chapter 16. Romans chapter 16, verses 25 through 27. It says here, now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. This moron Martin Richling years ago was coming out with this thing and he was saying, this is the key to the whole Bible right here. This revelation of the mystery there and power to establish you. And down here in verse 26, the commandment. So he was saying it's the establishment commandment. It's like, what? And he was like basing everything off of this. And you had to come to his system and, you know, become part of his cult and all this other stuff. You know, the guy was a nut. What this is talking about is the gospel. Okay, we're going to see that when we get over to the book of Ephesians. All right, this thing of the revelation of the mystery there, which was kept secret since the world began. We're going to see this as we continue. This is not some special system whereby you can build a cult out of it. All right, hyperdispensationalists are absolutely famous, or rather I should say infamous, for taking, and they'll just pick apart every little single word that you just pick it, pick. They just cut the whole thing up. I mean, you know, this whole controversy with this loser Ed Fenninger, and he's over in Romans 10. This word is not for you, and that word's for you, and this one, this verse here is not for you. This will send you to hell, and that one won't, and this one will, and that one, blah, 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 blah. You know, crazy. Devils is what these people have in them. But let's go to the next mystery. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. Says here, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Amen. That's another mark of a real good preacher. They will not be very sound like they're extremely educated. You know, hi. and, you know, all glory goes to the Lord for what he does through this ministry, through me. I thank the Lord for using me. Okay, I don't consider myself, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, pat myself on the back or anything. I'm just saying the fruit's there. you know, if you think, is, you know, is this ministry legitimate or whatever else? Yes, it is, because of what, you know, the power of God working through this ministry. But I'm not very good with my speech sometimes. I used to, you know, tell a joke. I'd say, you know, English is, I'm not very good with English. And people say, oh, what's your primary language? English, you know. Just an old uneducated hillbilly, I guess you could say. Verse 6, howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Yeah. You know, again, a lot of people are like, wow, brother, you're really, you know, we got a couple more letters today. When we get letters every time we go to the post office. And people are like, you know, I've gotten so many testimonies, people saying I've gone to church for 30 years and all this, and I've gone to seminary and I've gone to this and I've gone to that, and I've never heard preaching like you preach. You know, that you just make the Bible, you know, come alive. Well, praise the Lord. I'm thankful for that. But it's not about me. It's about the Lord speaking through me. And what I do in this ministry is there's no special little thing that you can, you know, special secret inner circle that you can subscribe to and what it, no. If the Lord shows me something, it's going to be coming out. All right. And that we get a lot of controversial stuff, and I'm just like going, okay, how do I put this together into a study? I got to make, you know, because I try as much as I can when I have studies come out. I try to put a lot of scripture in with it, because if you just bring out levels of truth without scripture, tying it into the Word of God, the truth that you bring out just falls flat. I've seen that. It always has to go back to the Word of God. That's very, very important. But again, there, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. You know, you look at the atheists and people like that, they're like, you're an idiot, you're this, you're that. Let me show you that. Why don't they get it? 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 through 21. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Absolutely. For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Yeah. That's right there. Again, you're seeing that in chapter 2. Paul is saying, hey, I'm not coming to you with great words of man's wisdom here and really impressive, you know, highly educated, whatever. Although Paul was very highly educated, but even he came in more of a humble spirit. It's a mystery. I mean, again, you know, God calls preachers into the ministry. You know, I honestly went into ministry just because I felt the call of the Lord, and I just wanted to prove that it wasn't a real call into the ministry. I mean, honest to God, that was why I went into the ministry. If you have not heard that before, I mean, the Lord started to put a burden within my heart. You know, I'm going to different church buildings, you know, Baptist churches and things, and I'm just like, they're not telling people the truth. And I'm meeting with the pastors, and I'm going, you know, why aren't you telling people, well, yeah, it's controversial, and, you know, and I'm just going, just come out with it. If it's true, if it's what the Bible says, then what on earth are you worried about? And the Lord started to put this burden in my heart, and it was like, well, I'll just kind of go and do something else, you know, and it was like the Lord's going, no, you won't. And everything I tried to do, you know, work in different places, and I was a wood turner for a while and things, and I got into chair making and rustic furniture making and whatever, and it was just like everything I tried to do just failed, and it was like there was no thrill in it. But I'd study the Bible, and I'd talk to people about the Bible, and I'd witness and whatever else, and I got to teach Sunday school classes and things, and it was like that was my driving, that's what I wanted out of life. I just want to talk about the Word of God. I want to share this truth that the Lord showed me through many, many years of study. And, you know, it just got to the point where I was like, okay, I'm going to try this thing. And, you know, I really don't want to be a full-time preacher or whatever. I like to talk about the Bible, but I knew the stress that was going to come from ministry. And so I went into it, and the Lord is just, I mean, here I am. What else can I say? I mean, it's incredible. And why? It's a mystery. I mean, there's a lot of people that would be far more qualified to take this ministry and preach and teach the Word of God, better qualified and better health and whatever else than me. But God looks down and He chooses the foolish things to confound the wise. And there's a lot of you out there that the world thinks that you're foolish for doing what you're doing and believing what you're believing. But that proves that you're qualified. If the world thinks that you're foolish, there's a good chance God has a place for you in ministry. The more despised you are in the eyes of the world, the more the calling is going to be there from the Lord. Remember that. Okay? And I'm speaking, you know, somewhat in jest or whatever, but I am also being honest. God will choose the foolish things to confound the wise. Let's look at the next mystery. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 through 53. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. You can keep reading there, but the point is, what is this? Well, you have the catching away of the body of Christ before the time of Jacob's trouble. Many call it the pre-trib rapture. All right, and again, don't, you know, I'm going to get the thing in the comments. There is no prayer for the pre-trib rapture. I mean, I have so many studies on it. You are without excuse. If you want to know about the rapture, pick a study. You know, I have got, I don't even know how many right now. It's crazy. Probably over 100 videos on the rapture proving it. Stuff that Nelson Darby never taught. Stuff that Ribeiro and Lacunza and all these supposed Jesuit founders of this, you know, dispensational and rapture teach. You know, it's, again, let me just kick that system while I'm right here. Anybody tells you that the rapture and dispensational teaching was created by Jesuits, don't even take them seriously. Why? Because dispensational teaching and the rapture belief system totally destroys Roman Catholic doctrine. So they, you know, would be destroying their own church, their own system. The whole point of the Jesuits is for the Counter-Reformation to bring people back to Rome. I mean, show me where Roman Catholics are talking about looking forward to the pre-trib rapture. They aren't. They say the opposite. They hate the rapture, the whole rapture doctrine, and they hate dispensational teaching. Jesuits did not come up with those teachings, right? That's just a ridiculous, stupid nonsense been put around. But again, you see these people and they say, I'm sorry, I'm just not convinced. You can't convince me that the body of Christ is going to be leaving before the Great Tribulation. I believe firmly that we're going to go through it and it's going to be a time of testing. And many people aren't going to make it, and blah, blah, blah. And it's just like, okay, do you realize what you're saying? And of course they don't. But Ephesians chapter 1, we'll be getting to it here in a little bit. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise until the day of redemption. But Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 through 11 says, if any man takes the mark, he goes to hell. Wait a second. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise in the Pauline epistles, but over in the book of Revelation, in the Great Tribulation that they say, not a Bible term, another issue. In that time period, if you take the mark, anybody that takes the mark goes to hell. Then that would make God a liar. You're sealed under the day of redemption for a Christian. But if you take the mark, you go to hell. That's a problem. Okay? Again, another one of the mysteries that is revealed to a Christian. I mean, you know, the first time you hear about the rapture, it's such a blessing. You just go, you mean to tell me all this bad stuff that's coming and we can just see the war, you know, wars like looming right on the very near horizon and all this other stuff. And there's going to be, I mean, you can just see the world getting more violent. There's like rioting everywhere in every country now. People just hateful and just, you know, and all these weather changes and things. It's getting scary. And to think, you read and you say, boy, the book of Revelation, man, that's scary stuff, you know. And you think of all this horrible stuff that's going to happen, and then you find out for the first time that mystery is revealed to you right here. Behold, I show you a mystery. And again, this isn't, you know, they'll say, well, you know, Paul's just describing what happens in Matthew chapter 24. Then why does he call it a mystery? And show me where dead saints are coming up in Matthew 24, Mark 13, or Luke chapter 17 or chapter 21. It's not there. So somebody's post-trib, they don't get the mystery. You know, I used to do this thing and go to Ephesians chapter 1 now. We'll go there. I used to say this thing, you know, I kind of fell for the little gentle, you know, politically correct nonsense, stupid lies of, well, post-trib, pre-trib, mid-trib, it doesn't matter. It's not that big a deal. I wouldn't divide over it. Oh, I divide over it now. After seeing how important it is, doctrinally speaking, if you go post-trib, you will get messed up, majorly messed up, doctrinally. All right. I mean, you're believing that you're going into a time of God's judgment and wrath, where if you do something, you can lose your salvation and go to hell as a member of the body of Christ. Cuckoo bird. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 9 through 14. It says here, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, there's the word dispensation, told you it was there, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Okay? That is the rapture there. The dead in Christ, their souls are up in heaven. They're in heaven. Those of us which are alive and remain here on the earth, my soul is right here, right now. Let's continue. Verse 11. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. Now here it is. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. There's the mystery. Right? The mystery is, again, this is, you know, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, okay, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. That's what's coming. This is another, you say, there are no scriptures to prove a pre-trib rapture. You're looking at the biggest one right there, in my opinion. Not 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 16 through 18. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 9 through 14. That's the biggest passage on the rapture, the catching away being before the time of Jacob's trouble. That's the real term. So I just don't get it. Well, then you ought to get saved. Because these mysteries are given to saved people, to separate us from the lost world. These people, you know, they just fight and fight and fight and fight and fight. And, you know, you will not have all the mysteries. Let me reiterate that again. You will not understand every single mystery when you first get saved. It's not just a boink, you know, you're just like, you know, call upon the name of the Lord and the Lord saves you. And all of a sudden it's just like, oh, you know, you feel like a in your head and you go, I understand all the mysteries. No, these things will come in time. But the whole point is when you get saved people that are genuinely saved and they hear these mysteries for the first time from a faithful steward of the mysteries, they go, well, that makes perfect sense. Why would I hate the Jews? Yeah, that doesn't make any sense. I can see blindness in part has happened to Israel. Yeah, I can get that. What about the mystery of the gospel? And what about the mystery of how God chooses the foolish things to confound the wise? Yeah, I got that. I'm foolish, you know. I mean, I can't believe God even saved me. I'm such a wicked person. You know, praise the Lord, he saved me. Praise the Lord, he's given me an opportunity to witness for him. And I got that. And I understand this mystery here. See, you hear about the rapture for the first time, you go, wow, I'm not going to have to go through that? Well, praise the Lord. Boy, I got that one. But you get these people. I'm sorry, I'm just not convinced. I'm not going to watch your videos. I'm not going to listen to your arguments. You're not going to convince me. Okay, you don't get the mysteries. You understand? Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Here we're going to see about, the dispensation thing. And how this ties into Romans chapter 16. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given to me to you word. Again, Paul calls the gospel over in Romans 16. He says, my gospel. All right. It was revealed to Paul. Look at this, verse 3. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when ye read ye may understand my knowledge and the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God the Father, regardless of what a bunch of satanic heretics say, you know, which we'll get into that. I'm getting ahead of myself. But what is the mystery here? The mystery, which we've seen, actually, there's like three references to the mystery here, is the gospel. You say, well, it's not really a mystery. You get saved, you go to heaven. Think about it. What's the mystery? God's dealing with the Jewish people. And all of a sudden, boom, God comes down to the earth, dies on the cross, and now the gospel was first taken to the Jews. It wasn't just, okay, everybody, hey, you know, come on in. No, it was first taken to the Jews. And when they nationally rejected Jesus Christ as their Messiah, individual Jews were getting saved, but nationally they rejected him as their Messiah. Now, okay, go to the Gentiles. And now all of a sudden, Gentiles and Jews come together in one body. So, What? You know what all this integration stuff is all about? It's a satanic counterfeit of what Jesus Christ does when he saves somebody. How about that? You say, what about feminism? So the rights of women. You get it when you get saved. And not before. If you want to be equal with men there, get saved. So what are you talking about? Galatians. Turn back one book. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. I'm an heir of what's coming to the nation of Israel. You say, but you're not an Israeli citizen. Yeah, I know that. You're not Jewish. I know that. I'm a German. Bavarian. If you want to be technical about it. The Denklingers come from Bavaria. That's our original name, you know. I have the book to prove it. But, you know, I'm not a Jew. Some people think I'm Jewish, but no, I'm not a Jew. I'm German, all right? But I get in on the promises that God gave to Abraham. Why? It's a mystery. See? Isn't that something? I'll show you another one. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself, for no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. Thank the Lord for that. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. Interesting. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. When we had our marriage little ceremony at our house church way back in Pennsylvania years and years ago, almost 5 years ago now, my wife and I, this is the passage we read. The brother that conducted the little ceremony there, he read this passage. These are the responsibilities of saved wife and saved husband. That's right there. And you know what? I understand a little bit more about the nature of the Lord and the church now that I've been married for, you know, a few years. I understand some things. I understand that used to be as a single guy, what I did, you know, really didn't matter. But now I have a wife that I'm accountable to, and she's accountable to me. It's a unique thing there, you see. When you're lost, you're not really accountable to the Lord. You'll answer before him, I understand that, but you're not really accountable to him until you get saved. And then all of a sudden you realize how much that he takes care of you and how much he provides for you. You're one flesh with him. You say, wait a second, are you saying, you talk about delusions of grandeur, you know, are you saying that you, me, you can't, I'm pointing at you, you know, Brian Denlinger is actually part of the body of Christ? Think about that for a minute. That's what I'm teaching, because that's what the Bible says. But you say, that's not possible. Jesus is in heaven. I'm looking at you here on the camera. I don't see, you know, it's some giant invisible leg going up or something, and I'm part of it. That's what the Bible says. So they can't understand that. It's because it's a mystery. It's a mystery revealed to us as Christians. You say, do you understand it? I believe it. It's a mystery. And I have no problem believing it. They say, what a bunch of foolish delusions of grandeur. You know, that's what the psychiatrist would say. Delusions of grandeur, that you actually think that you're in connection with God. You know, well, you don't get it. You're lost. You're on your way to hell. You see? You see how we're separated? Oh, let's just get along with lost. We can't. We can't. Well, you know, I'm really thinking, I'm kind of feeling uncomfortable, you know, and I just don't want to take a stance. If you're a Christian, if you're saved, you're never going to get along with the lost. Not going to happen. Colossians chapter 1. You're to be found faithful. A faithful steward of these mysteries, brethren. Well, I'm starting to have my doubts. They're trying to get you away from being faithful. Somebody doesn't get these mysteries, they don't understand it. They're against Israel. They hate the pre-trib rapture, I'll use that term. They don't believe in dispensational teaching. They say, you know, people are saved the whole way through the Bible. The Gospels from Genesis to Revelation. What are you talking about, you know? When's the last time you sacrificed an animal or took an animal down to the local temple there to have it sacrificed to atone for your sins? No, we're not saved the same way. Give me a break. Well, they were saved by looking forward to the cross. Well, the disciples didn't know that. Jesus tells them what death he's going to die, and they're going, be it far from thee, Lord. No. They weren't saved by looking forward to the cross. That's another satanic lie. The Baptists like to do that one. The non-dispensational Baptists, I've heard it most from them. Circus without a tent. Colossians chapter 1, verse 25 through 29. Let's look at the next mystery here. Whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but is now made manifest to his saints. Are you getting it? Well, I don't understand. I don't know what you're saying. Okay, then you're probably not one of the saints. And see, I'm not saying you're not a saint and you will never be, and I'll never tell you how. Man, get saved. You don't understand the mysteries? Something's there and you're going, I don't quite get it. Get saved. I mean, for goodness sake, there's nothing more important in this life than your salvation. Get it figured out quickly. Verse 27, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. You say, wait a second, did you just say Christ in you? No, actually, I said it, but I was reading it. So you're part of the body of Christ, you're in his body, and you just, are you saying to me that he's in your body? Yeah. See, I don't get that. It's because it's a mystery. You getting it yet? Well, I talk to some of these Christians, it's like they just don't get it. Because you're not dealing with Christians. But now is made manifest to his saints. Are you a saint? You are if you're saved. Truly born again. The mark of true conversion. I mean, you could have somebody, I always say that there has to be a change there and things like that, and there will be a change, obviously. I mean, if I tell you the cure for cancer and I say, now, you know, the way you're going to know if the cure worked is you're going to feel your appetite come back, you're going to have more energy, you're going to be not as tired, and your immune system's going to come back. That's just normal. But according to some of these Luciferians out there, they say, you get saved, there shouldn't be any change. There can be, but there doesn't have to be. What are you talking about? But the real evidence of true conversion is, what do they do with the mysteries? Now is made manifest to his saints. The Holy Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into these mysteries. He'll guide you into that truth. And if you meet somebody and they just, I just don't get it. I don't understand. I just can't agree with you. We'll have to agree to disagree. not on the mysteries. Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. That's kind of interesting. In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. Oh, brother. You know, there's a bunch of channels that they ought to just call it enticing words, you know, YouTube channel. I mean, it's incredible. They'll come and they'll have all these little things that get you so messed up. And, you know, it's sickening. But notice there, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. Now, how does that make sense for you if you believe that only God is the Father? Why would it say mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ? You know why? Because it's describing the same being. You say, well, no, you see, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Yeah, I've heard that one too. Chapter and verse, please. Oh, yeah, they don't have any. That's another thing. It's ridiculous. So there are three gods, apparently, according to those people. No, the Bible teaches there's one God. All right? And one Father. And Jesus Christ is that being. He's God the Father. We're going to see that here as we continue. Lost people don't get it. Why? Because it's a mystery. I'm going to convince you before we're done, if you're not convinced already. And, you know, again, it makes our job a lot easier, really, you know, because you start talking about these mysteries and the people are just like, I don't agree. You're wrong, and blah, blah, blah. You just go, okay, they're lost. You know, and I mean, you talk to somebody who's brand new saved and stuff like that. Well, you know, they might say, you know, could you explain this to me? But they will get it because the Holy Spirit's there. He'll lead them into that truth. It's now revealed to the saints, you see. Colossians chapter 4, verses 3 through 4. We'll see the next mystery. It says here, withal praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Yeah. The gospel that we preach is a mystery to lost people. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Second Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 7 through 9. Here's another one. That's an important one to get. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. If you've ever read any of the accounts of the Inquisition or Fox's Book of Martyrs or the Martyr's Mirror, or a lot of those things, the history of the Waldenses, you know, stuff like that, where they talk about what these Catholics, you know, do and things, you go, how could you hate people that bad to torture somebody? I mean, just horrifying, evil stuff. You just like makes you just break out into just chills, and you go, oh Lord, this is terrible. What's going on? Well, there's that mystery of iniquity that's there. It says here, doth already work. That spirit's there within those Roman Catholic people. Okay? And you say, well, I know Catholics and they're not that way. Yeah, I do too. But you see, it's because the Pope himself hasn't come out and made holy decrees and stuff and said, we need to fight for the faith, you know, and stuff. You start getting that. You know, the time will come when they that kill you will think that they do God's service. You know, the Bible talks about. You start to get that fervor, that they start to beat the war drums for Catholicism, and they have, you know, you throw in an apparition of Mary or two, and all of a sudden they're just like frothing at the mouth, wanting to kill you. It's a mystery. And again, part of that mystery is understanding, you know, how are we as Christians. You know, you get into this weird thing and you're going like, okay, I should fight against the coming Antichrist system, but yet it's supposed to be prophesied to come in. And you're going like, the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Okay, it's there. Can we stop it? No. Well, then we shouldn't fight against it. Yes, we should. But why should we fight against it if we can't stop it? It's like, you know, it's about getting people saved, brethren. It's a mystery. And you can, again, you can look at it and you go, well, you know, I understand that it's going to come in and stuff. And he shows up, the mystery of iniquity, until, you know, after he who now letteth will let, until it be taken out of the way. When the body of Christ leaves, the Antichrist can show up. All right? But again, another mystery. And you see these people and it's just like they're coming out with all this stuff. You know, Obama was the Antichrist. I mean, the one guy... Oh, who was it? I forget. Somebody was saying that. James Manning. This guy, this crazy black preacher. He was some nut, Harlem. Was it Harlem, Brooklyn, or something like that, New York, whatever. And he was saying he's good buddies with Ken Hovind and Lone Star 1776. Rudy Davis is the guy's name. And this is a wing nut. He was saying that Oprah Winfrey for a while was the Antichrist. It's like, what? You know? Not a steward of the mysteries, apparently. But let's continue. 1 Timothy chapter 3. And you know, I heard something here recently. I just want to make a mention of this because this Antichrist thing, this Jared Kushner guy, he's like Jewish or supposedly Jewish or something like this. Doesn't really look Jewish to me, but side issue. You know, but I actually look more Jewish than he does. But you know. But he's supposedly an Orthodox Jew and stuff, and his wife converted, you know, Ivanka Trump and stuff. She's converted Jew and all this other stuff, and he's going to broker a peace deal in the Middle East. And people are like, oh, you know, could he be the Antichrist? I don't know. I have no idea. But I really don't think he's even going to be in the spotlight until the body of Christ is left. I believe he's going to be, you know, hybrid, part man, you know, part devil kind of a deal. You know, you can think what you want there. I mean, Judas Iscariot, Jesus Christ calls him a devil. He doesn't say he's possessed with a devil. He says, one of you is a devil. So there's some of that stuff I don't understand. Again, the mystery of iniquity. All right. I look at it and I say, okay, I can clearly see he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed. And you read Revelation chapter 5, body of Christ is there, the 24 elders, and then the great multitude of angels. And then Revelation 6 is when the Antichrist shows up, when he's unleashed. So the body of Christ is in heaven before the Antichrist is unleashed. So I don't believe we're going to see who the Antichrist is and start going, I think it's Jared Kushner, or I think maybe it's Trump or something like that. I don't think that that's going to happen. Just wanted to say that as I'm going through this. 1 Timothy chapter 3, let's look at the next mystery. Verse 8. Likewise must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. And let these also first be proved, and let them use the office of a deacon, being found blameless. Okay, so again, I think that this is a tie-in to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, where it talks about, you know, being a steward of the mysteries and, you know, and being faithful in that. And again, you know, this is, well, I'm not a deacon. You know, some woman, some sister out there, and she says, well, I'm not a deacon. Okay, I understand that. But all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. So you can take a verse like this and say instruction in righteousness. Yeah, a deacon should be grave and not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre. But hey, I'm supposed to be that as a Christian, all right? Should I hold the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience? Yes. All of us should, not just deacons. But it's, you know, of course, obviously a lot more important for somebody in ministry. Okay, and to go next to the next mystery, this is another big one. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Mystery. God was manifest in the flesh. Jesus Christ is God. I've proved that many, many times. There are so many scriptures to prove this. Justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles. Wait a second. God is preached to the Gentiles? Yes, but in the person of Jesus Christ. You see? Believed on in the world. Jesus. Received up into glory. Acts chapter 1, it was Jesus that went up. He said, well, then this is a contradiction. No, there's no contradiction. Jesus Christ is God. Do you understand that? I'll show you another verse on this topic here. John chapter 1. Again, if you're new to this whole thing and you're going to get these little devil worshipers attacking you, Chris LaSala and you know, a bunch of the other ones, you know, Jesus is not God the Father, you know, and stuff. Yes, he is. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Okay? It's right there. Jesus is God. So, you say, well, you know, certain people don't get it. I don't get that. How could, you know, and you'll get these, you know, Muslims and stuff, and they come along and they say, if Jesus was God, then why would he pray to God? Well, it's a mystery that you don't get. You're not a steward of the mystery. See? God's not going to reveal things to you because you're not one of his saints. And you get all messed up and tangled up if you try to answer that thing and explain it and rationally, logically. No. You just say it's one of the mysteries. You're not going to understand it because you're lost. That's usually going to get them very angry. But the point is, that's the truth. There are certain things. You can't explain doctrine to somebody that's lost. You can't explain all these different things. You just say, hey, are you a sinner? Well, what about this? What about that? What about, are you a sinner? You know? Well, I'm not a bad person. Okay, bye. See ya. You're not damning their soul to hell when they do that. They're damning themselves to hell. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20. Let's see the next mystery. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Okay? You say, explain that to me. No. Why? Because I can't. You know, God's got seven angels in his hand that look like stars. You say, you actually believe that? Absolutely, every word of it. Yeah, I do. I'm going to see that someday. Then I'll understand. Okay? Revelation chapter 10. I mean, well, you know, why on earth would you want to believe in a book that offers you nothing better in eternity than what you have right here? You're going to have the same mind in eternity that you have here. You just get there and you go, oh, this is a nice place up here, Lord. Oh, did somebody miss painting that part of the mansion over there? Well, the eave wasn't built right. It's starting to get rainwater down in. It's starting to rot the foundation out. No, we're going to get up there and we're going to go, wow, okay. And the Lord's going to give us his understanding of things. And we're going to go, oh, okay. You know, I mean, the old hymn goes, farther along we'll know more about it. Farther along we'll understand why. You know, cheer up, my brother. You know, that goes in. I'm not going to sing the whole hymn for you, but you can look it up. But continuing here, Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Well, you see, that mystery is going to be over for us when we hear our name and come up hither. We're going to get there and we're going to say, face to face with Christ my Savior. Praise the Lord, it's finally here. You know, thank you, Lord. Wow, we're out of that cesspool down there on the earth. We're finally here in your presence. There he is. You know, all going to be straightened out. We go, ah, okay, all right, those mysteries. Yeah, that gets, I'm seeing it. You know, we'll get it then. But for the lost world, the mystery of God is not going to be over until the time of Jacob's trouble. That in that time period there, this mystery of God, where they're going, show me proof that God exists, they're going to see it. I mean, do you realize, you know, you talk about the spirits of the prophets and things, the mighty prophets of old and things. Well, there's a lot of mighty prophets today. Did you know that? A lot of atheists, they're prophesying their own future. You know, I don't believe in your God. Show me proof for your God. Oh boy, you're going to see it. You're going to see proof of God. Our text says so. And this Bible gets all these prophecies that are coming to pass in the world, and we can see it. It's just like, okay, there's another one, there's another one, there's another one. But I'm supposed to think to myself that it's just going to all of a sudden just fizzle out. It's been right up to this point in this time in history, but now it's just going to kind of, you know, not work. I don't think so. Revelation chapter 17, the two last mysteries. Revelation 17, verses 5 through 7. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, their mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns. There's a mystery system out there that performs mystical rituals where they turn wafers into flesh and grape wine into blood. And they say to you, come forward and open your mouth. Let's put this flesh on your tongue. Let's drink the blood. Cannibalism. But it's okay because you see, the priest has mystery powers. He can do transubstantiation and turn ordinary bread and wine into flesh and blood, but it still retains the appearance of it. Oh, and we have mystery secrets and systems of the Knights of Malta and the Jesuit order and the Knights of Columbus and the Knights of the Equestrian Order and the Knights and the Sisters and the Brothers and the blah, 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 blah. Mystery. You say, what's that crooked staff that you're carrying there with the cross and the crooked, scrawny little Jesus hanging off of it and stuff? What's a mystery? Why do you have this? Why would the Pope bring an Egyptian obelisk and put it in the center of St. Peter's Basilica out there, out in front with the Eightfold Path of Enlightenment coming in? Don't worry, it's a mystery. Can we as Christians know everything that's going on over there? No. A lot of that stuff is a mystery to us. The mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let the body of Christ. The mystery, you see, that we're one in Christ. We are in Christ. Christ is in us. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, who is tied in with Mystery Babylon. And the final one, Revelation 17, verse 18. And the woman, well, excuse me, this is not mystery, but this is just explaining who Mystery Babylon is. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. And it just cracks me up. You get these people that are pro-Vatican, or they might act like they're anti-Catholic, you know, whatever. I expose the Catholic Church and stuff like this. They won't bring up the Jesuits. They won't bring up a lot of the other secret things that the Catholic Church does. But they'll say, you know, obviously that Roman Catholicism cannot fulfill these scriptures in Revelation 17 because the Pope doesn't rule over the different nations. And you say, okay, well, let's look at the people that do rule the nations. Are they Knights of Malta? Yeah. Well, are they Knights of Columbus? Are they Knights of this? Are they Knights of that? Oh, well, this guy isn't. Oh, yeah, but he's Jesuit educated. Or he's a Roman Catholic himself. And when you're a Roman Catholic, you have two citizenships. One in Rome, when you get baptized into the Catholic Church, and the other to your country where you live. Guess which one you have to be subservient to? According to Catholic doctrine, I can show you. I've showed it in studies. I have all the books. Catechism, the Church teaches by Jesuit fathers. I have the Council of Trent right here, Baltimore Catechism, Second Vatican Council, Code of Canon Law, Latin English edition. I got it. I understand. But a lot of it remains a mystery to me. Why? Because I'm a steward of the mysteries. You understand? So, brethren, the reason a lot of us are getting into these debates with these people and things, and they say, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian. But they're so messed up on these different things. They preach another gospel. They are post-trib. They're non-dispensational. They don't believe that Jesus Christ is God the Father. You see? And you argue and argue and argue with these people. You're wasting your time. I saw this little Chris LaSala guy, you know, he comes out and he's like, I want you to do a live Skype thing. If I did a live Skype conversation with everybody that's ever attacked me, I would get nothing else done. And that's the whole point. I mean, why on earth am I going to have a conversation with somebody that is like, I've already showed the scriptures where they're wrong, and they're like, I want to have a discussion. I'm not going to discuss something like that. There's people dying and going to hell at the rate of thousands every minute right now. Okay? We live in a lost world where people die and they go to hell. What on earth are you doing wasting your time with people that are heretics and that don't want the truth? I mean, this is God's book, this King James Bible. And you say to somebody, let me give this to you. Here, let me show you the words of eternal life. God's book. I don't want anything to do with that. Go to somebody else. Oh, but that they might discredit my ministry and say, I don't care what people say. All right? If it was up to people, quote unquote, discrediting me and shutting my channel down and things like that, it would have happened a long time ago. The only reason you're still seeing my face and hearing my voice is because Almighty God has preserved this ministry. I can tell you that right now. All right? I'm going to be on YouTube as long as God sees fit. And I don't care what laws they come out with. I don't care what hate crime or your Islamophobia or other kind of stupid nonsense. God's going to preserve this ministry until he says, okay, you wicked devils down there, you can shut the channel down. Right? Is that going to happen before the rapture? I have no idea. I have no idea. I don't know what his plans are at this point in time. I can see, you know, that the desire to shut me down is getting more and more and more powerful as time goes by. There's so many videos now where I'm getting attacked and people cutting my stuff up and making me look like I'm saying things that I never said, you know. I mean, you can cut up anybody's, you know, things that they've written or things that they've said. I mean, you can do that with the Bible. Why do you think there are so many false churches and denominations out there and things? Because they cut up the scriptures. That's why. So, very, very important sermon. You know, I've known about a lot of these mysteries and things, and I've talked about them off and on, but I never had a dedicated study on this issue, and it's so very important because it shows us why there's so much dissension, because the mysteries are what God reveals to his saints. He'll show you things. So that is going to be it. We do thank you, of course, for your prayers. Just a little quick update for those of you that prayed about the situation with the real estate and all the other stuff and everything else. Literally within 48 hours, and it had been like a month that I had not heard anything from this realtor that I was dealing with. Within 48 hours, I got a phone call from him. I just came from the office actually about 2 hours ago. Well, maybe 3 hours now, but I was there today talking to him. Things are happening, okay? Still shaky. You know, like I said, there was some illegal construction done on our right-of-way, some property that we have and things, and it's kind of a bad situation right now. You know, it's something that the devil can use to sidetrack me from the ministry, and it's something I have to take care of. It's not like, well, just forget about it. I can't forget about it. It's major. So please keep the prayers going. It is working. I mean, I'm just like, I couldn't believe it. I mean, the phone rings and I'm like, whoa. I went in and talked to him. So prayer works. We thank you for your prayers. So that is going to be it. We will see you, I guess, in the next study. I'm trying to think of other things I got to get done, but we'll see you in the next study. Thank you very much for watching.